Today on Total Maine, a judge's decision scrutinized after a deadly police shooting at Auburn. A man with a violent criminal history released on bail. A retired justice of Maine's Supreme Judicial Court joins us in studio for insight. And surviving homelessness.
I also thought it was important that the public understand what homelessness really truly looks like.
After 3 years without a place to call home, his advocacy is now being backed by the ACLU of Maine. And Made in Maine, we visit a Biddeford clothing company sowing positive change in the community. Hello and welcome to Total Maine. I'm Terry Stackhouse. Thank you so much for joining us on this Sunday. Today we're examining the fallout after a standoff in Auburn that left the suspect and another man dead. In moments, we'll have a nuanced look at all of this as we sit down with a retired Maine Supreme Judicial Court Justice Donald Alexander. The suspect in this case, Leon Hinckley, had been released from jail just 3 days prior after an arrest on a probation violation involving a domestic violence case in 2011. Last Saturday, police say that Hinckley showed up at his ex-girlfriend's house with a gun. The ex's mother says that Hinckley's best friend was there with her daughter, knowing that he'd show up after getting out of jail. The mother claims that Hinckley started firing, killing the friend. Eventually, police shot and killed Hinckley.
We are all for a progressive criminal justice system that has alternative sentencing and does a lot of stuff. But this was the worst, in the whole spectrum of things, he is the worst of the worst and never should have been out.
The Maine Fraternal Order of Police and the Maine State Troopers Association said the justice system fell short. After Hinckley's arrest in May, the judge ordered a court-appointed attorney, but none were available. A week later, still no attorney. The court said it was a violation of his Sixth Amendment rights. So with no attorney available on June 12th, the judge, Sarah Churchill, reduced his bail with conditions and he was let go.
Remember, he'd only been in custody for 20 days. He hadn't been in custody for months at this point. Relatively speaking, that is not a significant amount of time.
They let him out, put him on house arrest without a bracelet. What's the sense? 48 hours later, this is what we have. 48 hours after he got out of jail.
The judicial branch, however, says that it's dangerous and short-sighted to blame the court here because the real issue is too few public defenders. Chief Justice Valerie Stanfill calls it a constitutional crisis, saying in a statement, every day, judges must make extraordinarily difficult decisions, balancing the constitutional rights of the accused with the needs of the public. Former Maine Supreme Judicial Court Justice Donald Alexander is joining us in studio. He's a retired justice with many years on the trial and the appellate benches. He's also now serving as a commissioner for the Maine Commission on Public Defense Services. Your Honor, thank you so much for joining us in studio today. We really do appreciate
glad it. Glad to be here, Terry. Thank you. I'm glad to. Very difficult case. I think we can all agree the first thing, this is a terrible tragedy.
Yeah. What stands out to you here? I mean, you know cases very similar to this inside
yes,
and out.
That's right. I've been there, done that on high visibility cases where, you know, you release someone based on your best estimate of what you know at the time, and then they go out and do something terrible. In my case, one case where a person went out and killed a police officer.
That was back in 1988.
That's right. And the difficulty in examining all of this is you have to make fairly snap decisions on fairly limited information in the many, many, many bail cases and cases whether you release someone on probation or all that judges see every day. And you think about it. I mean, there are lots of cases that have domestic violence related. There are lots of cases that have probation violations related, other violent crimes that you're making bail decisions on. If we just kept everybody locked up that had a bail problem or a probation violation or a domestic violence charge pending or something had happened, we don't have the space in the jail to fill them.
What do you make of the criticism of the judge here, Sarah Churchill? Is it fair?
I think it's very difficult because, again, you have to see what she had, what she knew at the time, including what she saw at the time, how she evaluated the person. And that's a very difficult thing. As I say, I've been there, done that. But I must say, even though in my situation, a person with a significantly violent history, some of which we knew, some of which we didn't, I released him over the state's objection. The state was wanting to, you know, higher bail. He went out and killed a police officer. But I did not see the targeted
You weren't named, for example, by the Fraternal Order of Police, like
I was. That's right. I mean, yes, my name was in the newspapers. People said, "Oh, this is awful." Reporters talked to me. I spoke back to them. Mm-hmm. But we had the courts had a different relationship with reporters than they do now. It was much more informal. There was a reporter covering the court. This was in Auburn. About every day, they knew me, I knew them, and you talked about cases in depth in a way that doesn't happen today.
But law enforcement specifically was not going to come out and say your name and criticize your choice.
To my knowledge, and again, I looked back at copies of the press at the time, I did not see law enforcement agencies or unions specifically targeting me. No, I didn't.
And late on Thursday, in a statement that was first provided to the Lewiston Sun Journal, Governor Mills citing her own experience previously serving as a defense attorney before she was the state's attorney general. She didn't name the judge here, but she was critical of the court's decision. What did you make of Governor Mills deciding to weigh in?
Well, I've had governors weigh in critical of decisions some that I've made. I don't recall any on bail release, but that happens. She's in a high visibility situation, it happens. I mean, as one who's with the court, I'm concerned about focusing on a case that is known to be very, very difficult for the judge and is based on a decision by the judge as to what the judge knew and saw at the time. Which, you know, is very different than what we know and saw now after this terrible tragedy. Always very different after the tragedy of the killing of the police officer in 1988 in Lewiston.
How does the shortage of public defenders that we see today compare to some of your previous years on the bench? For example, some data from the ACLU, which said that 658 defendants in Maine still waiting to be assigned a public defender.
That's very difficult because I don't recall a big difficulty in assigning counsel my whole time on the bench, and I sat in the trial court a lot while I was on the law court. I did get into a situation in 1985 where I had some difficulty getting attorneys in Washington County. This was at a time when, you know, caseloads were going up, and there was a increasing number of attorneys in Maine, but really not enough. And I had a thing that went to the Board of Overseers of the Bar, trying to say the attorneys have some obligation to consider things, and they issued an opinion says yes, attorneys should be, you know,
1 minute left, Your Honor, just
available to do things, but they can't be forced to do it by the court. But you know, there is we need to have attorneys. We need to be more welcoming to attorneys to do this, which is a concern that there is now about getting the number of attorneys. But the problem is the number of attorneys then makes bail decisions more difficult or probation decisions more difficult because you sometimes don't have the information, don't have the adequate background of the people when you have to make that decision, not when you something.
Last question, we have about 30 seconds. Could allowing non-attorneys to do more work on these cases, could that help at all?
I think the first thing we could focus on is having inviting and be more welcoming to getting attorneys to do these cases and also changing some of our bail practices so that we aren't talking about putting, you know, the people are in jail or on shoplifting charges and things like that. That's a problem that's affected the backlog and affected the demand for attorneys.
All right.
It's low-level cases, not this one, but low-level cases that shouldn't have jail with them and wouldn't qualify for court-appointed counsel if they didn't have jail with them.
All right. A lot to reflect on and a lot to learn from.
Yep.
Your Honor, thank you so much
for joining
us. Thank
you very much. Good to talk to you.
It really is a pleasure to chat with you.
Good to talk to you.
If you or someone you know is a victim of domestic violence, there is help and there are resources available. Advocates can offer a range of different services. You can start the process calling 211 Maine or the National Domestic Violence Hotline, 1-800-799-7233. We also have all of these numbers and more resources on our website right now, WMTW.com, and the app for Maine's Total Coverage.